this never-before-seen interview with Hilmer von Campe, former Nazi youth and POW escapee survivor, deals with God versus lies, good versus evil, and how the nightmare of Nazi Germany could be repeated here in the United States and worldwide. Our interview with Hilmer von Campe.
My name is Hilmer von Campe. I am of German origin. I grew up under the Nazis. I was a member of the Hitler Youth, and I am a World War II veteran. I thought I was defending my country, and it was a terrible awakening after the war when I came home that I had not defended my fatherland, but I had done the dirty job which Hitler and the Nazis had selected for us. And I began to study to find out why and how this could happen. And what I found was that the Nazi state was built on lies, and the Nazi ideology and the Nazi philosophy were built on lies, and that Germany went down the drain was because of godlessness. Godlessness means that I do act contrary, and or a nation acts contrary against God's commandments, which are for everybody everywhere, whether you believe in God or not. And I have tried to formulate an answer so that what happened in Germany at that time did not happen here again. And it is very disturbing that, in my view, we are very close to the same end. And I shall, during this interview, try to make clear that it is not the actions which are different in every country, but the way to a totalitarian system, and the Nazi state was a totalitarian system, is also built on lies. And that the most important thing today is to define the role of God in human society. And I will explain all of this in this interview, I hope. I was 7 when the Nazis took over in January 30, 1933. For me, that didn't mean anything. My father was what is here called, he was a head of a county. He was not as here, where you are elected, you were posted by the government. He was a civil servant. And he was asked to join the Nazi party. He refused, and he was immediately fired and was moved to, fired from his job. They couldn't fire him entirely, and then he was sent to a corner on much less income than he had. And that was a typical way of Nazi behavior. If you don't do what they want, they liquidate you, or they make you impossible. So we only noticed that we were moved from one city to the other. But saying from what I have learned then was that the Nazis' philosophy divided our family. There were the pro-Nazis and there was the no-Nazis against the Nazis, and my parents were under the no-Nazis. And the Nazis controlled all the media, which was only newspapers, radio, and film industry, and that was the way they indoctrinated the nation. And I was not aware of it when I was in the Hitler Youth. I took it for granted that is the government, and there was no doubt in our mind as children. And for my parents, it was the most important worry all the time to have their children not being indoctrinated and taken over by the Nazi ideology. and our parents could not speak to us openly about what was happening in the country, because the Gestapo, that is the state, secret state police, wanted to get at the parents via the children, who might give their parents up, makes problems for them, since they are harmless and don't know what they are being asked. My father used to listen to a German-speaking radio station from Switzerland, Bero Münster, late at night, so that we children might not see it. Otherwise, in the Hitler Youth, we did notice that we were being indoctrinated. Indoctrinated we were by the radios and by the news and by the school. We got the German history being explained in Nazi terms. And for the Nazis and for Hitler especially, his strategy was to make that the big thing where people would follow him. And he was very successful, that very many people thought he would bring glory to Germany, that they were all fooled and lied to. What Hitler said was, you need no more than 10,000 people to control a nation of 80 million people. And he didn't need to make us Nazis, because we were fighting his war, not defending our country. I thought I was defending Germany, and as I said earlier, it was a terrible awakening after the war, and I suppose I'll give you some more examples later on. Just as far as the war is concerned, my father said already in 1943 to my mother, and we got that from her, that you can't wish anymore that we win the war. So he knew exactly where we that we were taken over by evil. But we children, I was very happy. I was always afraid that I would be late before and not be able to enter the army before we had won the war. So that was a childish, but that is what I thought. We were on a train. I was a gunner in a tank. Well, we called that assault artillery. It was a tank without a tower. There came the news from the attempt to kill Hitler in 1944. And then they gave a list, long list in the radio of names of generals and of people who were involved in that attempt. And I thought to myself, there were very good German names. And I said to myself, what a pity that they did not succeed. So and that I remember distinctly, which means we didn't like the Nazis, but not so much on the ideology. It was on the, we didn't like the people. They were impertinent. They thought they knew everything. They tried to teach you everything. And especially they didn't like any control. They didn't want you to be, you couldn't dare to be of other opinion than they had, or they would have been in trouble. And we had, before our church, we sometimes had the Gestapo, two Gestapo agents in front of the church and taking down our names, everybody's names, intimidation, because their purpose was to destroy religion and destroy Christianity. Well, Hitler is known as having said, I have it in my book, I think, that he will wait some years and then he will destroy the churches and the Christians. That was his purpose. And I come to the reasoning later on. He created a group which is called the German Christians, who produced Christian teaching, who produced Nazi philosophy in religious language. So people dumb enough followed, thought that's very good. So he tried to get the Christians on the side of the Nazis. We were told in the Hitler Youth, but even more so in the schools, that it was, you can pray and sing hymns as much as you like in your homes or in your churches, but in society it is us, the National Socialists, who are in charge, and we determine what is going to happen or what is not going to happen. They had realized, like the Soviets, that a higher authority above the government would be an obstacle to their power plans. So they wanted to get God out of society and the Nazis in. And if I look, and then if I look at the United States of America, that is exactly what the ACLU is propagating. They are even, these people, these godless people, are even trying to change, to eliminate a reference to God on the casket or of the graves of our soldiers. They did exactly, they have been greatly successful in taking God out of society, out of education, and creating, especially under young people, a complete lack of understanding of what the world is like and what has to be done about it. And I say that, first of all, that the Nazis are not fascists, they are socialists. And as socialists, they are on the same, they come from the same fruit as communism and socialism. And I would say today, the American Congress, House and Senators, and White House, they are closer to the Nazis than they are to our founding fathers. And I cannot understand how the American people can tolerate a thing like this. And I have more examples. The Nazis killed 7 million or 6 million Jews in their concentration camps and 10 million more of others. We kill in our so-called free society, and that is the same in all of Western civilization, we are killing here 50 million unborn human beings, and that we are being represented as a nation by a group of people who tolerate this immorality, I don't have any words for this, that is being tolerated. And I think there is in the Declaration of Independence, in the second paragraph, it states that the government is to formed to defend the life, happiness, and of their people according to the demands of the Constitution. And if they do not do that, if they try to liquidate the Constitution, they should be removed by the people, and other people should be put into government who are committed to the reality of our Constitution, and I am on their side. The world consists of people, and what all people, whatever their race is, whatever their religion is, whatever their color is, they have the same human nature. And inside of every person, there is the voice of God and there is the voice of Satan, of the devil. And following the law of, I don't know how you would take it, following the voice of the lie within yourself leads to disaster in the personal and in the national life. And our founding fathers were very much aware, when they wrote the Constitution, that they had to produce something which made it very difficult to take over from outside or from inside. And I think there is a statistics about how many of what is in the Constitution comes from the Bible. And I have a whole package of literature about the founding fathers and their convictions that in order that people can be free. They have to have God in their lives and in their nation. And the Ten Commandments and the moral integrations which the Founding Fathers used for the Constitution makes it is only possible that it's being held and that people are free if they listen to the voice of God inside and follow his commandments. The Nazis threw God and his commandments out of our or any area of decision. They, godless people, determined what is to be done. And here, it is now the same. We have Obama is being idolized in the schools. That is what Hitler did. Hitler went after the World War veterans. These people ran after the people who want money from the government. And that is not a basis for no nation. It is on the greatness of America. It's their commitment to truth and doing this that it became the richest nation on earth. And now they come on here and want to have a part of it for doing nothing. One has to remember, or one has to know, that everything what happens is about power. With other words, it is the power of God against the power of man. God wants us to be free. Man wants to control each other. And everything what we now experience here in this country, that has, it were other things or other themes. But the motivation is always the same. It is power for us. So all this discussion, and it is not, the issue is not capitalism versus communism or socialism. Socialism and communism are consequences of immorality of those who guide their philosophy then and the people and the nations who they have under them. They want to control. So everything you hear now, especially with the health, the health program, where they want to put the government in charge, they have nothing to do with the medicine or with better serving of a healing people, as the doctors and the hospitals have to do. They want to control what is the heart of the lives of the people so that they decide and make the people dependent on them. So I repeat, it is not a battle between communism and capitalism, even though the consequence of the philosophy of the Founding Fathers made us the richest nation on earth. The issue is not, I repeat it, capitalism versus socialism. It is God versus man. It is good versus evil. And it is God against godlessness. And since I have experienced godlessness in Germany and see the destruction of my family, the destruction of the nation, and then I see the same forces at work here, I shudder that people don't notice it. And our Congress people in Congress, we don't want any bilateral or bipartisan decisions. We want that Obama and the Democrats are being stopped with what the destruction of America which they have embarked upon. We had a nation, and I said it earlier, which was just 20 years about, not even 15 years after World War I, which we had lost. And the Treaty of Versailles was not a peace treaty, it was a treaty to enrich themselves for the others on German expense. And we had an inflation, which is coming here, may come also this way, where you need $1 to change it into German marks, would you have to pay $1 million, $2 million, $10 million marks for $1. And my mother, when she came, my father was paid, and my mother got there twice a day. My mother got there with a suitcase, and then the paper mummy was put into that suitcase, and then she ran into the city, not to buy what she wanted, but to see what she could get for those with this money she had. And that day for day, and I don't understand until today how people could live by that, and I shudder at the thought that people have the same here. That is the one side, and Hitler, very well aware of the mentality of the German people. We had about 6 million unemployed. He went after the veterans. And you can say that the German nation marched in German Gleichschritt. That means we have the same step into disaster. We knew that you can't be in opposition to the Nazi. You have that we knew. And the elder you were, the more you realized. I was 18 when I got into the army, and I was fully aware what I was doing. I didn't realize that I was already brainwashed, and I had a very. And when I get to Germany, and tell the people what is happening here, they don't believe me. They just don't believe me. That any nation can be so dumb and go after the same immorality as under the Nazis. I heard many speeches. I didn't hear or I didn't see ever Hitler, but I heard the Nazis speaking. I heard in the school we had a teacher, when he spoke of God, he made jokes about God and where you put your rope into it, and then he laughed and everybody laughed. Found that comical, but we didn't know what he was laughing about. But you got those things where you realized that you could not say everything you wanted. And only afterwards you realize what effort the Nazis made to eliminate any opposite voice in the nation. It's like what they're doing here, trying to make a law at the back of the people where they want to finish you, for instance, because you speak and work for the truth, and they don't want that. And they want to keep their lie, keep the lie. And the lie is not different on what the Nazis told us, and you can see afterwards how true it was to say that they are liars. I repeat, we got always the Nazi philosophy in very many aspects where we don't recognize them. I have in the Hitler Youth in two small cities, I have never consciously experienced that I'm being brainwashed. But I was brainwashed, assuming that a totalitarian system and a leader like Hitler can bring us to freedom. And peace never occurred to me. That was a state, that was a government, that was our army, and that is, we are Germans, so you be for Germans. Each person has to look for information which he believes could be honest. Because what the newspapers say, most of them, the so-called mainline newspapers, or the politicians, it's all built on lies. That's not so easy to find out. How wrong they are. You have to judge them by their actions. The whole education system here is wrong. It's not in the Constitution that the federal government should run the education. It's a matter of the states of the Union. But the Nazis in school had Darwinism, the evolution theory, which is against God and his creation. It's the same here. So how on earth can the children know what is right and wrong? It is the parents who don't fight. It's the people who seduce these children. But the responsibility is with the parents, and the families are being destroyed by the same immorality of which the left is throwing out at all sides. How can the children know what is right and wrong? I don't know how many million divorced families there are, and people who grow up without father or without mother because they can't work, live with each other. That has to be cured. That is the way to make it impossible to be taken over. I hope that makes that clear. Mm-hmm. That makes it, I fight that battle, and if the Christians stand up, they would change and really fight for what is right and not for what is wrong. I think we could change the situation fast. The Führer, that is Hitler, said so and so, and then everyone had here, hooray, and they did it. And the Nazi functionaries, they didn't think for themselves, and they were very small-minded. They thought they knew all the answers, and they told people what they should do. And there were very few people who dared not to do what they were being told. As you say, there was no definition for what the rights are, what the society is based upon, of the German working like nobody else. It was all pro-German and had always a sense that we are better than the others. And a lot of people fell for it. Here in America, the wrong is first of all being promoted as a virtue. But it is the road to a totalitarian system, because a totalitarian system is the abandonment of God's commandments. And where men can only, those who do that, they can only rule if they control everybody. And if you have no moral standards, then you can't judge. If you don't have moral standards, a Christian has to live by the moral standards, and not by the expectation of heaven. Because if you follow the moral standards of God, your way will be all right, and you will recognize who is against it, and then you can think what to do about it. So we have this here in America right now, the judges who do as they see fit, and they introduce legislation which is contrary to God's commandments, and Congress doing nothing. That is the road to disaster. Because we had no really law in Germany at that time. The law was made by the Nazis. And they made a law that the Jews are no good and they had absolutely no right anymore. Now they have other, here it is not the Jews, but here is others. It's those who are against you or against the government, where the government decides what is right for you and what is wrong for you, and if you don't do it, we will teach you. So that is a very dangerous road if that happens. What I'm saying is that this, what we just discussed, that men decide, groups decide, individuals decide what is right and wrong, it is no different to a nation not knowing what is right and wrong. And I speak, when I say the role of God in human society is a lifeline of the battle which we have to fight. This is part of what I call the insurrection of humanity against God, which means the organized retreat from God's commandments in the national infrastructure, or the infrastructure of a nation, where God's commandments are being taken out and new, like abortion, for instance, in most Western countries, has become part of the law. It may be passed of the law, but it is not lawful and it is immoral. It is murder. And you have various things like this which are being proposed by the same politicians who at the same time want to lead you in a collective socialist society. You can clearly state that socialism is an immoral proposition. It's not a right position, it's an immoral and wrong position. And every soldier, if he hears me speak, can take it for granted that that is the truth, and everything which has to do with it has to be destroyed or has to be finished, thrown out. My escape from prisoner of war camp in communist Yugoslavia is in so far of importance as it gave me the basis to recognize what I am experiencing afterwards. So I left. We were five soldiers who decided that we would not survive the winter because there was no real food, and it became cold and we had nothing to put on. So five of us left, and the plan was to go to Hungary, and from Hungary to Austria, and within Austria was the demarcation line between the Soviet army and the British army, who were occupying Germany and Austria at that time. And in the first night when we left the camp, we lost the guy with a map, and the four of us continued. We walked according to the moon, and to the North Star. We had to go northeast. We had to cross one river between Hungary and Yugoslavia, and when we came close to the river, it was very cold, and I said, I'm not going to swim through it. I rather give up to the authorities, whatever that may cost me. When we came to the water, it was a death penalty on trying to escape. When we came to the river, we found a boat underwater lying there waiting for us. We had one person of the Navy there, and we got it floating, and we crossed the river. Then we realized that we're still in Yugoslavia. We had to cross the main river. This was a side river of the same thing. So when we came 2 days later, or 2 nights later, to the main river, we again found a boat, which this time it was tied at a tree. And we crossed the water, and we were in Hungary. So we got, for the first time, by the population, they gave us what's really to eat. But there were very few men. They were either prisoner of war there on either side in the war, or they were dead. And we went to a farmhouse in the morning after walking through the night, and they put us up. Once we were late, and apparently some people had seen us disappear in this small farm, which was occupied by two women, and they welcomed us and gave us to eat, and then they said we could sleep in the stable. We were scarcely in the stable. They came back shouting, soldiers, soldiers, and I saw them coming with a dog, and they're coming after us. So we were two at that time. We had split into two and two, and we ran for cover to some bushes which were very close. We had to go through via a field which was plowed, you say. So you could see my footsteps. I lost my papers. They were all, the ones I have there, they were all over the thing, so you could not miss really seeing that. And then we came down in the bushes. And then we saw the Soviets with shishu in the air coming into the village, pick up my cap. I could see them pick up my cap, and then they turned around and went in the opposite direction. I had absolutely no explanation how that is possible. And then we waited. At that time, we waited in the bushes until it became night. Then we went to the two women, elderly women, in the farm, and they begged us that we disappear immediately. They knew, as we did, that if the Soviets would find us with them, we were all dead. I sat down instead in a chair and said I wanted to have something to eat first. And they gave me something to eat, and then we went away. And I was very proud about what a wonderful organizer I am. And when I had crossed, there are very many instances like this. These are the three main instances. And when I had crossed the last border, which was between the Soviet Army and the British Army, I realized that I was on the side of freedom, and I was not anymore under the Soviet menace. And then I thought of the whole thing, and I was wondering whether God had taken me out of the prison camp and out of Yugoslavia and brought me here. And I said, if that was God, then he must have a purpose for me. We were educated in the Christian way, but I had in the war never prayed. It never occurred to me that I might die. So this was something very new inside myself. And only 4 years later, when I faced myself, the reality of myself, and I realized that I am a hypocrite and a fake Christian, and I was full of sin, that I realized that I am no better than the Nazis, because what the Nazis were liars and I was liars. The Nazis lied for power, I lied for personal gain. And when I went to Washington one day, and I was received twice by the then executive director of the Holocaust Memorial Center in Washington, I apologized to him for what the German government and the German people had done to his people, and asked him to forgive me and my nation. And the man was very moved, and so was I. And we became friends. And I told him that when people look at the Holocaust, at the criminals, the guys who did it, they were the criminals, and they have to be made responsible. But I am no better, and they have to be punished. But I was not punishable, but I was, he said, the real enemy, or the real ones, I said to the executive director, who are responsible for this are those people, the bystanders, the ones who cannot fly, kill a fly, but stand up for nothing. And I think that is very much a picture which I see from many people here in the States, especially in the Christian churches, who exactly, with whatever reason, do not engage themselves in the battle for the future of our children and grandchildren. And the experience of this encounter with the executive Dr. David Weinstein, I shall carry until the end of my days in my memory. The message I have for America, and the warning I give, it is not possible to be liar and be a stepstone to freedom. Freedom is only possible with honest people, and I would say with Christian people who have made a commitment to God to love their neighbor as you love yourself, and do what is right. And I think that is where Hitler got us, that he gave the German people the aspect of honor and being great again. It was a national growing under him to begin with. But all those who thought he was doing it, he did the contrary. And the fruit of what he did was the destruction of the country. And everybody who tries to put a nation in the jacket of socialism, communism, is part of a system which denies God and destroys the freedom and the spirit of humanity. And that is why I am in this battle, because I realized that I was, when I realized who I am, one of the first thoughts I had, how I had treated the two women in Hungary, when I wanted food and they wanted to get rid of me. I didn't think a moment about their destiny. I was very ashamed, And I couldn't ask them for forgiveness. I asked God to forgive me. What I want to say is that without change in human nature, and human nature is the same all across the world, without change of human nature, which means a new orientation of your motives, nothing good is to come out of what you do or what your nation do. And your nation, and America is one of the few nations which does have a mission, which is freedom, not just for one's own nation, but freedom for the world. But freedom without truth is not possible. That's why we say the battle for freedom is a battle for truth. And you have to get rid of hatred. My mother hated the Nazis. She hated the British who threw us out in West Germany, out of our where we lived. And we hated our host where we lived, in this house we lived. When she realized that she was a fake Christian like myself, and that she was full of hate that she should love, she realized she couldn't. She just could not get rid of the hatred, because she made the Nazis responsible for the disaster of our family, for the disaster of our country. And she went down on her, and the hatred is what has to be healed. And hatred is the same which motivates the totalitarian system, the communists, the Nazis, the socialists, the liberals, the and most people, they don't call resentments hatred, but resentment is hatred. My mother went down off their knees and said to God, God, if you are up there, I know that I am a Christian. I know, and I know that you know that I am full of hatred. I cannot get rid of it, and I do not get up here before you help me to do that and liberate me of my hatred. It took her 2 months, and she got up and was a very happy woman, something which no son can wish more for his mother, and she went to battle for the souls of people from there on. So that I wanted to say, that are the fundamentals, a part of the fundamentals of what is necessary to change the direction which America has taken now. And what happened then in 1945 is no different in its motivation of what happens here today, and it has to be changed. Well, people who don't have, let me put it very casually, a sense for the rights of other people, have no other way to their own power by destroying them. Put them in a prison, put them in a camp, kill them. Or let them, if those people who think they are getting now financial help will realize by the government and vote for them, they will realize that the promises are all lies, because they are not directed at them. They are directed at the power of those who want to have the power and distribute other people's fortunes to those who don't have it, instead of helping them to stand on his own feet. And human nature, if left to himself or to itself, will always lead to immorality. The immorality of a Nazi is the immorality as is different as the immorality of a person who changes everybody, his lover or something of that nature, who lets go on sexual behavior as a main purpose of his life, or you try to get more money out of somebody else, or it's all things which naturally evolve if they listen to the wrong voice inside themselves. And the only ones who can change them are God with themselves. They themselves have to find their own ways by measuring their own life on absolute moral standards, absolute honesty, absolute purity, absolute unselfishness, and absolute love. That are standards which will be very difficult to live out, and there are not very many people, if ever, can do it. but as a standard, they are necessary. And then people can create a peaceful society in which people can live in freedom. There are many things where the stronger go over the poor or go over the weaker people, like the Nazis did, like I did. And I had to ask God for forgiveness for that I have betrayed his commandments. And ever since, they are the basis of my life. So in other words, my escape, which was a pure miracle. I was like the Jews being led out of Egypt, really motivate my whole life, because I thought, as I am, so is my nation. And if I am responsible for that Hitler could do what he did, there are millions of others who need to change. I'm not judging. I'm not even judging myself. I'm defining what is right and wrong. And people, please, go ahead and do the same. Become a force for freedom of everybody on this globe, and that America can fulfill on the basis of our Constitution the mission God gave this nation. Don't give it away to a bunch of people who want their own power and want to rule about you and who will destroy humanity. We thought this are the British and the French are the same enemies as World War I. And now they come back at us. So we believe what Hitler said, that they were attacking us. Now they come back to us, and we cannot tolerate that happens. What happened in 1918 is happening again. We first have to win the war, and then we can deal with the Nazis. Imagine how dumb we were. And that was what I thought. I went to fight for my country. I wanted you to do good what the earlier generation had missed and had brought us into defeat. So that's what they do. They lie. Hitler lied himself into power. And I think Obama lied himself into power too. I cannot say anything else. And the lie can go nowhere. They had lied for 6 months, 6 years already, or 5 years already, by constantly, step by step, they made laws that the Jew is a type of person which has no right to live. As I said, every German knew that. I knew it. I even went through the Jewish streets in our city, and we sang anti-Semitic songs. We children played with, I had forgotten that, my sister knows all of these things. We had played with our neighbors who was a Jewish teacher. And the lie that they were lived abroad to, they came in October, my father was already not there anymore. He was in the new city where he had been sent to. I was awakened with somebody knocking at my windows, a friend of mine who now lives in Hamburg. And he said, come, this is very exciting. And that's where the synagogue burned. So I knew also that. So everybody knew how they were treated. All the city in our case, and all the nation in everybody's case. And the excuse was they were no good and had to work, and they came in working camps. That is as illegal and immoral as killing a person, to treat a whole group of people that way. And they had all the German laws, the Nuremberg laws, they are called. And so that was right in the Nazi sense, but not right in God's sense. So that's, and there was no more like this. Everybody knew it, but we did not know that they were being killed. What is called Holocaust, that I discovered after the war. It took him about a year. First of all, he had eliminated every opposition, parties, groups, trade unions, everything. The only Nazi-style organizations. that he had already in 1933, a few months, he had that under control. Then he lied about the chief of the army, and later on to the chief of the armed forces. There was the chancellor was not the head of the armed forces. The armed forces had a field marshal who was in charge of the three branches. So he made this chief, who was the chief general, he pushed him out, and he pushed the general out who was leading the army. And therewith he had the whole control about everything. He had excluded the military, would have been the only ones who could have stopped Hitler and saved democracy. I even feel in America the same atmosphere as we had in Germany under the Nazis, when you get insecure about your own government. And if you add to that what is being done and not even given to the voters, we are on the same road down to destruction. And I will do everything I can to make myself fighting for the right of the freedom of this nation and the rest of the world. In the Soviet Union and in Nazi Germany, you have what we call the party line. There is a line given out, and you have to stick to it. The political correctness, which even has still is not totally eliminated, is where somebody lays out what is right and what is wrong, and then you have the newspapers and the media to make this line stick. Goebbels, the chief liar of Hitler, he used to say, you have to tell a lie long enough, and then always something is going to stick. And that is a principle which I have seen here already earlier. That is how the people are indoctrinated and brainwashed, that they think that what they think is right, and the only thing which has been put into them from outside. The United Nations is a godless grouping. I have never heard that they have ever taken position, which is not their business anyway, about moral standards and achievements. And if, for instance, in some country you have a dictator, he doesn't need even to be totalitarian, but he is a dictator, and he treats his people badly, and he treats himself very well, that they're being excluded from their voting rights. It's a completely immoral organization, where you even Fidel Castro has a vote. And now, this guy signs America into that outfit where is not one nation who has the moral foundation which this nation has. And they will destroy us. They will pull us down to their low level. And that a president who has not even proven that he is an American, and where he not even has proven that he is eligible for the White House, that he signs a treaty putting us into this godless instrument of the devil, that shows, and if people don't realize it, that comes, you are brainwashed. You have to go to the right literature. You have to read what the reality is. You have to be real yourself. And we should not do it. We should not get into United Nations. Absolutely not. Then comes Mao Zedong or Khrushchev or people of their descendants and tell us what we shall do. And they are better at that as we. I think there was, like myself, there were millions of cowards. Because if you do speak out here, you may lose your job. But if you there, you'll lose your life and you think twice. especially if you have a family. But it was the organized churches, under the leadership of their pastors, should have stand up. And there was nothing of this. As I said earlier, every German knew the injustice which was done to the Jews, but it was not called injustice. And the same is if you say abortion, and Obama says he doesn't know it, and Pelosi says, I have been dealing with this all the time, and I don't see why it should prevent the abortion. If you think that you can be a Christian and vote somebody into power who is in favor of abortion, you should not vote for him. If you do, you are part of the criminal, the crime they are committing. And America is still the only nation where the substance of Christian teaching is in force in the lives of very many people. My own pastor is standing up and saying that I don't care about what they say about the taxes, which I will lose. I don't care of it. I only have to learn what are the battle lines where I have to fight. But I want to have a part in the battle for freedom. That, and I think all the pastors who think in the similar way should form a fast organization or organism where they can change ideas and act as a unit, as a Christian unit, who says God and Constitution. That is what we want, and not money and destruction. We want a president and a Congress which obey God and not who lie. I think every thinking person has to take a position in this battle, because the battle line goes through every office and through most families. So make a decision and begin to fight for truth. That's my message. You have to do that. Everything the government orders, I am against it. Most things, everything what they do is aimed at their own power, not at what they ask others to do, where and what. They use the they use something to forward their goal. That is the essence of the tactic of the totalitarians. They use everything not even to embrace something which is good, but they don't embrace it because it is good for somebody or for the nation, but because it helps them to take control. So everything suggests, if I would be a congressman or a senator, I would say no, whatever good reasons they might bring. And now comes the Republicans and says we must have a bilateral decision, and then they work for hours and days and weeks. Completely, they don't know what the real enemy is. The problem is that our government, and this is not just Obama, this is all of them, they don't know who their enemies are and what the battlefield is. But many people know what our rights are. And if you start with fighting for your rights, that is okay. You land up against the socialists in any case if you do that. So everybody has to start. You can't start with being an angel, but you can start with what you know is wrong. And there you have to fight, whatever it costs you. I don't have it here. There is a statistics about the founding fathers. And what they have put their, as I have, their whole, what they have, they have lost their fortunes, putting it into the battle for freedom. I would say about half of the 56 signatures, they have put themselves into it, and we have become so comfortable that we don't want to lose our comfort. I don't like my wife and my house and my comfort. I like that very much, but it does not dominate me. It does not dominate. It's not my priority.
Making money is not my priority, but I need money, of course. So money in itself is not wrong. But it's how you use it, that is the point. And I use what I have for the battle for freedom.